Do please sit down. We've just been singing in the third verse, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. And that's it's old language, but it encapsulates wonderfully what's at the heart of the Christian gospel. That when we come to God, sorry for the wrong things we've done, sorry as well for the good things we could have done and haven't done. When we come sorry for those things and repentant, turning away from them, then God forgives us, pardon for sin. But more than that, there's a peace that endureth because we don't have to live with the guilt of those things. We can know God's peace with us, peace with God and the peace of God. So I wonder if you turn to the blue service cards, paragraph 5. And there's a prayer there of repentance, a prayer saying sorry for how we have gone wrong. And then I'll say after that a prayer of God's mercy to us. Let's just be quiet for a moment and read that, and then I'll invite you to say it if you wish to. We pray, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Do you ever have days where, if you're honest, you struggle to have the strength to face what the day may bring? I think the truth is we all sometimes have days like that. And there's a great verse in Isaiah 41, verse 10, and it says this: So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Because whatever a day brings, if we're leaning on God, we can know the strength that he alone can give us to face each day. Our next song reflects on this. It's number 1221 in the books. Praise is Rising. And it has these words: Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Number 1221.
Praise is rising. This prayer is based on the second commandment, love your neighbor as yourself. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, not long ago we celebrated the birth of your only Son. Isaiah 9:6 says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. It is so great that God sent his Son to pay for our sins and bring us the gospel. During World War I, in the winter of 1914, on the battlefields of Flanders, one of the most unusual events in history took place. The Germans had been in fierce battle with the British and French. Both sides were dug in, safe in muddy-made trenches, 2 to 2.5 meters deep. That seemed to stretch forever. But it was Christmas, and what happened next was astonishing, writes Stanley Weintraub, author of the book Silent Night, The Story of World War I, Christmas Truth. The Germans set trees and lit candles. They started to sing carols. The words were not familiar to the British, but the tunes were. After a short time, the British came out the trenches and also began to sing. Both sides fraternized with each other. They shared rations and started a football match. Thank you, Lord. Amen. The next day, fighting started again. We all remembered the command, love your neighbor as yourself. This was practiced for a brief time. Our God would want us to always practice this. God sent his Son into the world to reveal his love for us so we may live through him. 1 John 4:9. I pray that all here in church fully believe in God and the Lord Jesus. This is the only way to be saved. I would also like to pray for all who are not well mentioned on the service sheet. Hilary and I got infected with COVID after Christmas, but we hardly knew that we had it. The test said we were positive. Now the test says we are negative. I very much pray that all who can will accept to be vaccinated. I believe it says in the Bible that we should look after our health. Not to be vaccinated is against this command from God. I pray all this in Jesus' glorious name. Amen.
Peter. Our next song is number 1100 in the books, and it's a prayer that God will, as it were, open the eyes of our hearts. And it's an appropriate song to be singing before we have the Bible reading and then before John comes to speak to us. Number 1100, open the eyes of our heart, of my heart, Lord.
Thank you.
Do please sit down for our Bible reading.
The Bible reading is taken from 1 Peter chapter 3, starting at verse 8, and this can be found on page 1221 in the Church Bibles. 1 Peter chapter 3, starting at verse 8. Finally, all of you, have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil, or reviling for reviling, but in the contrary, bless, for to this you are called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts regard Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for the sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to the spirits in prison, because they formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight persons, were brought safely through water. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's pray together. O God, help us to listen to your word with understanding, to receive it with faith, and to obey it for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. A couple of days ago, I was browsing on the internet and came across Instagram and looked, and it was interesting. There was a bit posted by a church, I think it was in Exeter, and it was a challenge. And it was a challenge that I'll give to you this morning as well, because I think it's brilliant. It says, express your faith in three words. What three words sum up your faith? Now, it's very easy, you know, we could sort of say, right, you know, Christ in all and something like that, and be very trite and say, well, that's what is expected. But what about us as individuals? How do we express our faith? And I think it's something that we could really sort of think about, seriously think about what and why we believe. Actually, I don't think that my seeing it on the internet was a coincidence. I don't believe in coincidences, because I believe it really sort of talks about what we're talking about in verses 15 and 16 of our passage here. But in your hearts, regard Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience. That really fits in, doesn't it, with that challenge. What is your faith? How would you express it? And we're not asked to defend the gospel. I think the Lord's well capable of defending the gospel himself. But we are expected to be able to say what we believe and why. Defend our own faith. But it also means that we're not to be defensive. We can offer a defense of what we believe, but not to be defensive. Not, what do you want to know that for? You know, you've got to be sort of, we have to take that as a starting point. Somebody has perhaps come to you and said, I see that you're claiming to be a Christian, or you're behaving like a Christian. Why? What is it you believe? And you know, and Jesus in that sort of situation, he wouldn't have said, oh, well, you know, I haven't got time to talk to you about that now. He'd have actually come and started where the person who was making the inquiry was. In other words, if somebody is a long way from God, Jesus would start with them and bring them gradually and explain to them, not browbeat them, not be defensive, but to lead them towards the truth. And you know, there's another challenge there, isn't there? Are our lives such that people are attracted by the way in which we behave? Is there a difference in our behaviour, in our attitudes, because we are Christians? Someone once said, don't know who, we may be the only gospel that somebody else reads. That's a challenge, isn't it? Our lives might be the only thing that sort of somebody's on that particular occasion finds attractive, that brings them towards a faith. As we go through our Christian walk, we must be aware of the way in which we live and behave and attract people to the Lord. And we are reminded of our gospel, we're reminded of our faith, that Jesus died and rose again. Verse 18. Jesus suffered and died once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Isn't that a lovely verse? Jesus died and suffered, the righteous for the unrighteous. He didn't wait for us to get better. He didn't wait for us to turn in faith and try and struggle. A lot of other religions struggle to try and please God. But we don't struggle to try and please God. Jesus, before we turn to him,
died and rose again for us to take away our sin. He had the victory over death. So we don't struggle to please God, but we do expect the Holy Spirit to transform our lives as a result of our faith and our question and the way in which we behave. We should be living in a way that actually does cause people to ask questions about our faith. Why do we believe? Why are you behaving in a different sort of way? So we then come back to the beginning, more to the beginning of our passage. And Peter lists several characteristics that are a mark of the Christian. Finally, he says, all of you have unity, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart and a humble mind. John 17, Jesus prayed for his disciples. He prayed that they would be one, just as he and the Father are one. And it's a challenge for us. As Christ's body, at the church, we are also human and fallible. And there are differences of opinion, differences of interpretation. But all of those, we should be united in the overall loyalty to our Lord Jesus. There will be differences because we are human. But we are together. We are one body. We strive for unity. The second characteristic that Peter mentions is sympathy. And again, using the image of the body, as Paul does. If one part suffers, then all suffer. If one part rejoices, then all rejoices. Again, this is the idea of being involved with each part of our Christian fellows, our Christian family. Brotherly love. In John 13, Jesus says to his disciples, a new commandment I give you, love one another. So people will know that you are my disciples. To be of a tender heart, says Jesus, says Peter in this passage. In other words, compassion. Do we have compassion for other people? What are our attitudes to those people who don't yet know our Lord and Saviour as their Saviour? What's our compassion for the world? And you know, it's easy, isn't it, to become hardened to statistics. We know that over 150,000 people have died of COVID in this country. We think, oh, 150,000, that's a lot. But does it actually make an impact on us? Or do we not just think of it as a number? Or do we think of individuals? And perhaps with that, perhaps there are people who are close to people who have passed away from COVID or are suffering from COVID. So it becomes individuals, and we become more tender-hearted. We care more for those around us. We're told also to be of a humble mind. We might think we're good. We might think we've got all the sort of the things we need to live our own life. And that, isn't that the problem with people who haven't trusted in our Lord Jesus, that they say that, well, you know, I can run my own life. I don't need anybody else. We know if we've trusted in our Lord Jesus, if we have his call on our lives, we know that we are dependent on him for our life, and not just for today, but into eternity. Yes, he gives us gifts and abilities to use and to be subject to his will. And finally, we're asked to forgive. We're commanded to forgive, aren't we, in the Lord's Prayer? It says, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive others. And in verse 9, it reflects that sentiment. Don't repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but bless. A challenge, isn't it, to Christian living? And it's backed up by a quote from Psalm 34. Whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. How can we live up to it? And it's only through the power of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, who lives in the lives of all who have put their trust in our Lord Jesus. And we need to allow him to make us aware of our dependence on God, and to allow him to change our lives, to give us the strength to live in the way in which we are called. Jesus died and rose again. He rose again for all people, for all time. And this is the meaning of the very difficult passage to understand and interpret, verses 19 to 22. The most accepted interpretation is that after he died, Jesus went to the place of the departed. And this is the spirits who were in prison. In a sense, when we read and hear the creed, which says that that Jesus descended into hell, that is the wrong. Hell was a place of punishment, whereas Hades, the place of the departed, is where Jesus went to those people who had died without, before Jesus' time, obviously. So he was, I think the significance of this particular passage is that there is no part of the universe, no part of the living or the dead, where Jesus hasn't proclaimed the gospel. So it gives us reassurance of those who have maybe gone before they hadn't heard about Jesus, that God knows what he's doing, and he will be the judge and welcome each person. He wants everyone to come to him. Some obviously will say no, but he wants everyone to be part his kingdom. Peter uses Noah as an illustration of people who were saved through the water, and he uses that same analogy for baptism. And interestingly, in the Greek, it talks about it says baptism, which corresponds to this, and the corresponding bit is a Greek word meaning type, and also the word antitype. In other words, it's like a seal, and the sort of the imprint of the seal is left after you've taken it off. And that shows the way in which things that happened in the Old Testament are reflected in the New as well. So we have the picture of Jesus going to being relevant in all places and in all times. Peter uses the analogy of baptism. Not just the spiritual, not just the physical act of water, but also the spiritual purpose. The passage finishes on the person of Jesus. The person of Jesus who became one of us, died for us, rose again for us, and is seated at the right hand of God. And is God, part of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit. So let's give him the praise and the worship that he deserves. Amen.
Thank you, John. I just want to read again verse 18 that John read to us. If your Bibles are still open, it's on page 1221. As John was reminding us, a great statement of the good news we share. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. Such a great promise that Jesus died for us. And I wonder if you picked up a really telling thing that John said, that we might be the only gospel someone hears today. We might be the only gospel someone hears today. So let's just be quiet for a moment to reflect on those two things, the wonderful good news of Jesus and our witness. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you so much that you suffered once for sins, for the sins of the whole world. Thank you that you went to the cross as the only righteous man that had ever lived. And thank you that you did that for each of us, that you might bring us to God. Help us to know the joy of that, but help us as well in how we are, in how we speak, to share the gospel with those who don't yet know it. Amen. Our closing song is number 997 in the books. Because life is not about us, it's about Jesus. Jesus, lover of my soul, number 997.
Fires in your gaze.
Do please sit down. I wonder if you take the blue cards for one last time. And paragraph 13, there's a prayer for the morning. Let's say this prayer together. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you that you have brought us safely to the beginning of this day. Keep us from falling into sin or running into danger. Order us in all our doings and guide us to do always what is righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among us and remain with us always. Amen.